Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother, Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. I am really excited about introducing a new series called The Underlying Reasons. And this series here will deal with everything that concerns Muslim women, and especially the bad treatment. Because these underlying reasons, even though they are aged 1,400 years ago, but they are still kept alive, even though they openly contradict the Qur'an, and these reasons are still used to badly control women today. The underlying reasons, like an iceberg, the tip is what Muslims are doing today. But really the reasons as to why they are doing what they are doing, it what lies beneath the iceberg, and that is at least 10 times bigger than the reality of what it is. Those underlying reasons are here, or this series will be here, inshallah, to help clear the man-made mess and help the Qur'an lead the way one more time. Because as you will come to see, there are so many things that Muslims are doing today, and every time you ask them as to why you are doing what you are doing, they always have an answer. It is a sunnah. But again, has Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam truly said these things? Have these things that are being done today really, really, really been approved by Allah and His Messenger? For example, there are some stories, for example, this issue here, where the mother takes three times over the father because a man is pretended to have gone to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, man ahaqqu an-nas bi suhbati, who deserves better of my companionship? And they said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, your mother. And then he answered again the same question, your mother, your mother. And here the people have come up with this idea, which we dingle in front of the eyes of every non-Muslim out there, that look at how great Islam is, because it gave 70%, 75% of the attention of the child to the mother, while 25% of that is given to the father. But this ideology, as beautiful as it might sound, contradicts the Quran 100%, because Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. We have commanded, we have trusted, we have told, we have taught, we have left, we have written, we have prescribed on al-insan, and this is the human being, no matter what their race or religion or whatever, biwalidayh, with both parents. So as you can see here, the hadith says 75 for the mother, the Quran says 100% is split between the mother and the father. For example, other issues as to how we are being treated today, both men and women, and especially women. When you look at the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how has he treated his wife Khadija? So many times we are told the reason why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam married so many women, 9, 11, 13. Again, the scholars are in a big contradictory arguments as to how many women the Prophet married, and I will deal this with the underlying reasons and why the difference of this opinion. Because when you look at Islam that we have today, is full of contradictions. The only thing that doesn't have contradictions is Al-Quran. But Al-Quran is, as I said so many times, is at the back seat. And this is why we end up with all these things. But in any way, for example, one of those underlying reasons is they say Rasulullah married so many women because so that we can have a better understanding about his life from different angles. Because every woman will relate to us what she's seeing from a different angle, right? So all this is what is said. However, when you look in the books of hadith, you will find 99% of what's being told to us is by our mother Aisha, Allah be pleased with her, while the majority of the wives of Rasulullah, we hardly ever hear about them. Maybe a hadith here and a hadith there, and that is that. So where has that argument gone then? Another example of these things. You see, a salesman, when you go and want to buy something from them, let's say this shop sells a particular brand of washing machines. So when you go to the salesman, he will ensure, and this is one of the hidden strategies, he will ensure that your mind will never, ever err into something away from what he wants you to believe. So he will speak in a particular manner, he will say some things, he will bring some virtues and some benefits of the machine that will stop you thinking about the other machines. The same thing that is happening today in our world today. Muslims, we are programmed into thinking into a particular way that will not allow us to think outside of the box, and this has created a lot of problems. In my job these days, I am most of the time, 99% of my job is being done outside on the road. And it has given me an opportunity to look at what is going on outside there. There is a common denominator amongst Muslim women today that the hijab is boxed into just covering the hair, when in fact the Muslim woman, as any other woman there, wears tight jeans, very tight, explosive jeans. She's wearing skirts, she's showing off her chest, she's everything is like any other woman out there. The only thing that says that this woman is Muslim and the other one is not Muslim is the coverage of the hair. So now, where is the underlying reason and why the hijab has been cornered into just covering the head? We will go through this. Is the hijab that women are wearing today was really the hijab that the women wore at the time of Rasulullah? Or is it influenced by some kind of ideologies or some school of thoughts? We will see this exactly on its due time. For example, man should have a beard. Is this what al-Islam really said, or this is what some school of thought have said? The Salat of al-Jum'ah, is it truly compulsory for men and not compulsory for women? Or there is some cooking that has gone and undertaken some shape there to make it must for a gender and not a must for the other gender? I witnessed an experience one day, and that experience was this young man. I invited some people for dinner, and he was talking about his daughter, and he said, "My daughter is 4 years of age," and he is telling this story as a boastful father. He goes, "And my daughter wears the hijab. She is covered the hair and everything." And he goes, "If you tried to remove the hair cover, the daughter will cry. She will throw a fit. And I thought that is strange, but I didn't say a word until I witnessed it someday. Back then I was working in an Islamic center, and this guy was with his daughter, and he was proving that what he said was true. And lo and behold, the guy says to the daughter, "Remove your hair, the headscarf," and the girl clings on. She is 4 years of age. She's not like 19 or 20. She's 4 years of age. And then she clings on to her headscarf so tight that you think like they were gonna, I don't know what was gonna, someone might wanna kill her. And then he tried to pull it out, and the girl clings onto her headscarf and starts screaming her life out. "No, don't they?" And she started crying. And that moment there, it freaked me out. And I told him, "What have you done to this girl? How did she reach that when you touch her headscarf, she throws a fit like this? What have you told the girl? She is 4 years of age. She doesn't understand hellfire. She doesn't understand nothing, my brother. And even Islamically speaking, she is not bound by anything of Islam. The pen has not started writing on her. What did you tell her?" But anyway, roll on the years. I haven't seen that person for so long because the guy had some extremist thoughts. So for so long, I haven't seen him until one day I heard, and he was crying and complaining, that his daughter has completely removed the hijab and decided not to follow Islam anymore. And her school was very supportive of her decision. How it happened? One day, his wife went on to wait for his 15 years of age daughter to bring her out of school. The girl didn't come out of school. The woman waited. And then she went inside and she found everyone's lips sealed. They didn't tell her where the girl has gone. So the woman starts panicking. She calls the father. The father comes home to the school. They wouldn't tell him. The next day, he tried, no matter how he tried. They wouldn't tell him where his daughter was until 3 days. The social services got involved. The police got involved. The school got involved. The girl was elsewhere. The girl was living out there because she was scared. She had complained to the school that because she doesn't want to wear this hijab, she doesn't want to go home because her father or her mother might kill her. And then it ended up going to the court and everything, and the girl stopped wearing the hijab. The 4 years girl ended up not wanting to wear the hijab because they had so much brainwashed her, scared her and everything. But when she reached the age where she had to decide for herself what she wants, she didn't want to see these things. I can tell you thousands of stories of girls that married non-Muslim men because they had lost faith in this Islam. So many people today are up to a huge surprise in their future. Our generations are not so much. Yes, at one point they will be so extremist, but one day they're going to rebel and everything is going to go down the drain. And so many people, and by yourself, I'm sure you know of a story or two of people that have said, enough, we don't want this Islam anymore. But why is it? Is it Islam truly, or is it the man-made Islam? The underlying reasons, my sister and my brothers, will help you get the true facts away from any school of thoughts, away from any agendas, hidden agendas, except prioritizing the book of Allah and the true sunnah of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he meant it, not as played with by the men of religion and the packaged to us under names of hadith. And if you don't believe in the hadith, you're going to go to hellfire forever, which is absolutely untrue, as you will see. One of the great problems I'm facing these days, really is one of my biggest problems, is when I am telling people, Allah says in Al-Quran, and the answer 99.99% is always comes back, but Rasulullah said. Until now, I tell people, are you committing shirk? Are you putting what Rasulullah said on the same level as what Allah says? People do not realize the gravity of putting a hadith at the same level of the ayah in Al-Quran. I'm impossible. This is one of my biggest challenges, to actually make people see. For example, women in Islam are so degraded that if I personally, Abu Hanifa, was a woman, I wouldn't be in this Islam at all. So kudos and high points for you girls that are in Islam and steadfast. Because so much of these contradictions these days make you bang your head against the wall. In our books of fiqh, in our books of hadith, the woman absolutely has no right. I will tell you this. For example, they will tell you that Al-Islam gave women the right to inherit, right? So a woman can inherit. And we say, MashaAllah, that's great. But what they don't tell you that is causing a great headache to people is that a woman is not free to do as she pleases in her inheritance without the permission of her husband. What this means is, yes, she can inherit money from her parents, but then again, once the money is in her bank account, she has no authority of doing with her money what she wants except with the permission of a completely foreign guy to her inheritance. That's her husband. Without his permission, she can't do that. And if she did anything without his permission, what she did is void, and what she has done is a disobedience to Allah and his messenger, and it is haram and blah, 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 blah. You see how we lie? You see how we lie to the world out there? Pretty soon, one day, our girls and our boys will not accept the Islam because the way we present it to them is so un-Islamic that it will create a big deal of problems for us. We have a very tough choice to make today, my brothers and my sisters. Most of you are parents. If you're not a parent, you're gonna be a parent one day. then what's going to happen is your child will be faced with a version of Islam that will go against everything that the world praises. Human rights and all these things, freedom of expression, freedom of religion, freedom for whatever. And yet you teach them something that is not in the Qur'an and you force it down the drains. And guess what? One day the child will be facing a very, very huge dilemma. What Islam claims to be is completely different than what the beauty of this world are. So who do I go with? With a religion that promotes negativity or with a world that promotes positivity? And so many Muslims today are living Islam. Yes, we say Islam is the fastest growing religion, but as we Muslims are well known, we can't take criticism very well. Yes, there are so many people that are entering Islam, but even greater people are leaving Islam. A daughter, you tell her the niqab is it's compulsory from Allah, the hijab, the way it is, with the 8 conditions that the scholars have put, is a must, and she must wear it on all the... So you brainwash the kid into thinking about the perfection of Islam. But once they grow, they reach the 13, 14, and they get their phone, they get on the internet, accessing the internet is so easy today, it's unbelievably easy, and the child goes to Muslim lands, Muslim countries, and they will see women are not dressed as you told them. Then women don't behave, women don't do what you have idealized to them, and then they will be hit with this huge problem between their eyes. What is the truth? And in this situation here, you will either tell your child that the rest of the world, Muslim world, are evil because they're doing something evil, or you will help your child leave Islam. Underlying reasons will give you the right tools to understand what Allah wants from you in Al-Quran without any human, political, cultural, or sociological agendas. The Islam we preach in today is not, and I will say it again, apart from the Salat and the fasting and the Zakat and all these things, all everything that is sociological, that regards the community, the Islam we practice today, from men wearing those long qamis, going to the masjid, which is absolutely 100% cultural. It's got nothing to do with Islam. While outside, I see somebody in King's College wearing a qamis and a long beard, an absolutely grumpy looking dude. And they think like they are like the Sahaba because he's dressed like the Sahaba dressed, and be and rest assured that is not how the Sahaba dressed, as Ibn al-Qayyim has very well detailed in his book Zadul Ma'ad, in chapter number 1, when he speaks about how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam dressed up, and the qamis was not one of the greatest of the dresses. But how did we Muslims end up with these things? How did we? Why are Muslims today, especially those Salafi Wahhabi school of thoughts, why do they say that the siwak is better than washing your mouth with toothpaste? What did Rasulullah ﷺ really emphasize on the siwak, or the main point of his teachings was to clean one's mouth? Anyway, so many problems we are faced today, so many things in Al-Quran are pointing to the greatness of mankind, yet the man-made mess and the man-made designed cultural Islam is creating more havoc. One day, as I was in my talks, and even one of the ladies in the group, before she left the group, she said there is an American Islam. I told her, she asked me, have you heard of the American Islam? I said, no, I haven't heard of this. Again, it's the Saudis branding some... You see, whenever they don't want you to believe in something, they brand it very negatively. An American Islam, attacking women, attacking chastity of women. What do you mean attacking? A woman cannot in Saudi Arabia. It's impossible for any woman to go outside in the streets alone because she'll be hijacked and raped. What are you talking about? She can't even drive. She can't even control her world. She can't do a lot of things, a woman in Saudi Arabia. Don't believe me? Go on YouTube and watch how women activists in Saudi Arabia are treated. Scholars are abandoned in the street because the government refused to speak to her. But anyway, this lady tells me Islam is being Americanized. And I say, how? She goes, well, some people say. I said to her, but my sister, that's what the Quran says. And she was surprised. And I said, there is no such thing called American Islam. This is only the Saudis wanting again to lock your mind to stupidity. That's all it is. For them, so that you remain stupid, you will just, oh, that's an American Islam. One of the universities I was also given a talk. And this Saudi man came to me and he goes, the American Islam. I said, my brother, that is not American Islam. I'm telling you, Allah says in the Quran. And you tell me, American Islam, what's wrong with you? Why, he says? I said to him, why do you say that? Because it doesn't mention the ahadith that his scholar have put at the forefront and abandoned the Quran behind. Well, in these underlying reasons, I will tell you why it's happening, what's happening. The underlying reason why the scholars are pushing for that agenda. On the other side of the coin, why Al-Quran says what it says and how we should behave. And then maybe it's too late for you, my sister, to educate your husband. And maybe it's too late for you to interact in certain manner, but because you are a mother, And you, my brother, you are a father. Perhaps what I say will help you bring a very balanced kids, and they will educate their children in the proper way. And maybe 2-3 generations from now, Muslims and Islam will be a better place than where we are today. Again, the underlying reasons will be, inshallah, an uncovering. It will take about 29 to 30 minutes, not more than that. But every topic will be given due, from saying assalamu alaikum to non-Muslims to everything. And the very first talk about this is about a woman who was asked by a Muslim man to give up herself to him. And when she refused, he got angry. This, inshallah, will be gifted in the next day, tomorrow, bi-idhnillah. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. And I pray to Allah to give me enough time in my life to cover the issues that I want to cover. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. If you want to join my group, please send me a message on WhatsApp at 078-7640-8735. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.